You're listening to a High Voltage Radio Network podcast. Find more at highvoltageradio.com.
This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Welcome to the Kings of Sport, the program that's changing the game one show at a time, with your hosts, Nate Milton.
Yes! That boy's good!
And Marcus Vandenberg.
Let's say!
So sit back and relax, because you're now down with the Kings.
And welcome to the Kings of Sport, the program changing the game one show at a time, a.k.a. the world's most dangerous sports show, a.k.a. iTunes' longest-running weekly episodic program produced and hosted by two or more African-Americans who are not affiliated with a major network. I'm your host, the Godfather, Nate Milton. This is episode two of the Patreon era, if you will. So shout-out to the people on Patreon at the $5 or above level who are getting to of this podcast, and also shout out to the rest of y'all out there listening to the classic version, shall we say, of the Kings of Sport podcast. I can't do this alone, though, so I have to introduce my co-host all the way in Southern California. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Marcus. I shut him down. Vandenberg, how you doing this week, brother?
What's up, Nate? How are you?
I'm good, my friend. You know, had some issues with my back. You know, we get a little bit older.
What is this?
You can try to fight it all you want with your light skin and your good hair, but it's it's coming for you, brother. Have you seen a picture of Elder Barge lately?
Well, I also don't use drugs, so that's a fair comparison.
Fair point. I jacked up my back a little bit at work, and so I had to go to the doctor yesterday. And they gave me a Toradol shot, so I'm doing the show under the influence. It was funny because it was like a little old black lady that was the nurse, and she gave me the Toradol shot, and so I had to like pull down my shorts a little bit, and you know I'm a Southern gentleman, so I didn't go all the way with it. I didn't go Vince McMahon kiss my ass club with it. I just a little pull down, and she's like, "Now, baby, you're gonna have to do more than that. I don't need a whole show, but I need a little bit more." So I'm like, okay, I'm not gonna argue with the woman with the needle. Yeah. So she gave me the Toradol shot, and they gave me some other medication, like muscle relaxers and stuff like that. So that's why I want to talk to you about this real quick, Marcus, because I had this crazy dream, and I don't know if it was because of the muscle relaxers or the Toradol shot, but I had a dream that not only did the New Orleans Saints lose a football game on a blatantly obvious pass interference call. But I also had a dream that Tom Brady and the Patriots, and the referees, if you want to go there. I'm not saying I'm going there or not. But Tom Brady beat young Patrick Mahomes. Tell me those were both, like, medicine-inflicted dreams.
No, that actually happened, Nate.
So you're telling me Jared Goff and Tom Brady going to be playing in the Super Bowl next week?
That is correct.
Damn!
Wait, you're a Falcons fan. You should want the Rams in.
Now you remember our conversation last week. I wanted the pettiness to manifest. I wanted Drew Brees to win last week and then lose in the Super Bowl.
Nah, as someone who was in Atlanta for the game last Sunday, the right team won. It would have not ended well if the Saints were in Atlanta for a week.
Now you can't have Who Dat Nation running up and down Peachtree.
And we've seen this week how Who Dat Nation acts when they lose. I mean, this is pretty ridiculous. We'll get to that.
Mike Mills.
Yeah, come on, Mike, get your people.
let's start with the NFC then, Marcus, because I got a lot to say about the AFC game. But let's talk some NFC off the top here. What did you make of that game? Obviously, being a newly reborn Rams fan these past couple years. What did you make of the matchup between the Saints and the Los Angeles Rams?
I think the Rams got very lucky. you know, I as much as the refs blew that game, I think the Saints were also responsible for that loss. There were a couple opportunities early in the game where they set up for field goals when, you know, if you score even one touchdown out of one of those field goals, it's a different game. Some of the play calling in the second half was a little suspect. So it's not totally on the refs. I can understand why Saints fans are mad, but at the same time, the Saints did not do everything they could to put the game away. And you let the Rams linger, and the Rams are good enough to come back and find themselves in a situation where a blatant lack of pass interference is going to, you know, determine the outcome of the game. And that's what happened. Despite all that, the fact that Brett Zierlein made that field goal so easily. I mean, that was from 57, and it probably would have been good from 67. So I am cautiously optimistic about the Super Bowl with the Rams.
The Rams have never been this popular amongst the country.
This is America's team now, the LA Rams. I mean, they're a likable team.
I think they got a shot. They got a shot. We'll talk about that here in a second with the Patriots. But going back to the game against the Saints, I agree that there was some opportunities the Saints didn't catch on. I was kind of surprised Peyton wasn't as aggressive with his play calling as he usually is. He felt a little bit buttoned down at times. And you got to give credit to the Rams. Bad pass interference call aside, they put themselves in a position to be there to take advantage of that egregious call by just hanging with the Saints. And so, you know, we talked last week. I thought it was going to be close until halftime, and then New Orleans was going to pull away, but they stayed with them. So you got to give props to Goff and, you know, your mans and them, C.J. Anderson, for having the freshest legs in the playoffs.
I mean, it, you know, Todd Gurley was a non-factor in that game.
Yeah. I was really surprised about that.
If you're New England, you got to be a little worried because you figure if he is a little banged up, the extra week off will sort of get him right. And if he's, you know, 70%, I think C.J. Anderson has now shown that he's a capable running back at this stage of the season. So, you know, if they get anything out of Gurley in the Super Bowl, I think they have a good shot at being the Patriots.
Well, let's talk about the Patriots, Marcus Vandenberg, because this was I think this might have been what had hurt my back in the first place. Mm-hmm. Having to push back against all the waves and waves of the Tom Brady fan club trying to come at me on these social media streets. I had to push him back, and so I think I might have pulled a muscle or something. But once again, they did it, Marcus. They found some way by hook or by crook to make it to the Super Bowl. What did you think of the performance? Because it was, in some ways, it was very similar to the regular season game. We saw them play against Pat Mahomes and them boys. But mm-hmm. in other ways, it felt like, especially going down to the end, it felt like a prototypical Patriots game.
It did. Brady was not 100%. He was not sharp. I mean, he had the two interceptions. He should have had a third interception.
Should have had three.
Yeah, should have had three. But when it mattered the most, I mean, that last drive in overtime, it was sort of like, all right, you sort of knew once they won the coin flip that the Chiefs were in trouble. And Brady made that look so easy driving down the field that I think at some point the Kansas City defense just knew. They were sort of deflated that, all right, this is going to actually happen. So it's unfortunate Patrick Mahomes didn't get a chance to show what he'd do in overtime. But I think their future is going to be bright regardless. You know, they fired their defensive coordinator, which the defense was sort of been the issue all season long. And probably the Chiefs are probably lucky to even make it this far based on how poor the defense was. So I think they have not missed Kareem Hunt at all. They have sort of found a replacement in Damian Williams, so they sort of locked up to a multi-year deal, and they have Spencer Ware. So I think the offense will be fine. If they wanted to add another receiver to sort of take the Sammy Watkins role, that would probably be an upgrade. And if they somehow can improve the defense, I saw that Rex Ryan was sort of being tossed out as a possible coordinator for the Chiefs, which would be interesting. I think they'll be probably the favorites, I would guess, to get back to the AFC title game.
I would agree. I think for the Chiefs, we knew going into the game what their weakness was, and it was put on display in those last two drives, the final drive of regulation and then the last drive of overtime when the Patriots went down and scored. And they pretty much used the same exact playbook on each drive, you know, whether it was Edelman up the middle or Gronk to the outside. They didn't have an answer for it. And so that you're right. Once the Patriots won the coin toss, I was like, it's over. Because I think if the Chiefs had won the coin toss, they probably would have gone down and scored on the Patriots. So that was the most important coin toss in the postseason this week. So
what are your thoughts on the overtime rule?
Honestly, I think this overtime is better than the old rules, but I still would like to see maybe just 5 more minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Just like extra time instead of possessions. But then again, you run into the question of the other team might not have the opportunity to hold the ball.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think this is better than what they had, but it stinks when you have arguably the most impressive player in the league this season. It was probably going to be the MVP. And he doesn't get a chance to at least go on a drive and see if they can score some points. It leaves a bad taste to your mouth. Doubly bad when it's the Patriots on the other end of the benefit of the coin flip. But you got to tip your cap to Brady and him. I mean, Brady is, as we'll hear in a future rant on the Patreon page, Tom Brady might be the greatest system quarterback in the history of system quarterbacks.
that is not my hot take.
as my take, I'm sticking to it. But yeah, it's funny because I didn't even watch the game. That's how much I hate the Patriots. I didn't even watch the game until the very end when the Chiefs were coming back. I was like, okay, I owe it to Showtime to see if they can score. I just watched this. And then they scored, and I'm like, okay. And then on the next play on the defense, we had the interception that was called back because you had a man offsides. And mm-hmm. I was excited. I thought this was it. This was the changing of the guard. Tom Brady was passing the torch. He was being John Cena. He was being benevolent to the new up-and-coming star. But no, he turned into Hulk Hogan, and he had to have his spot. And he
Brady must back. Pose.
Yeah, yep. I mean, not today, kid. I'm going over, brother.
Yeah.
But I agree with you, though. I think the Chiefs have a bright future. Particularly if they can get some help on defense, whether that's through free agency or the draft, like that mm-hmm. would be my top priority because you've got an offense. Let's say the offense doesn't change from the personnel they have right now. They're still one of the better offenses in the AFC. So
yeah.
I would like to see Andy Reid retool that defense and give him another shot next year.
Yeah. It was an enjoyable day of football. I was
This whole season, like we talked about, this whole season has been pretty good.
I mean, I was sort of down on the NFL last year for a variety of reasons. One being sort of the actual games itself, I just didn't really find compelling. But
no.
This season has been pretty damn good.
Yeah, like this is if you were somebody that I know a couple people that are protesting the NFL
for still? Various
reasons. Yeah, and they, you know they're talking to me when I bring up what's going on. They're like, "Oh, you still watch that, brother? How can you watch that?" I'm like, I mean, it's good this year. it was easy to boycott last year because the games were kind of bad.
This is just like wrestling, you know. I think people do say the same thing, like, "Oh, I don't watch Raw, I don't watch SmackDown." But
yeah,
if the product was good again, people would back on.
I don't watch Raw and SmackDown, but I will watch WrestleMania. You know, that's different.
Yeah. Speaking of people not watching football, there are two cities now that are pretty dead set on not watching the Super Bowl. You have St. Louis, who is still very upset about what happened with that. So they, you know, I would expect their rating in St. Louis to be pretty low compared to other Super Bowls. And now you have New Orleans, who, you know, I'm trying to think of another fan base that would respond the same way as the Saints if this were to happen to them. It would, if the Rams were in a situation and they lost because of this, the Rams fans would not care. LA would not. LA would move on because, you know, it's LA. New Orleans, though.
New Orleans fans would be pretty bad. Philly fans would be bad.
Philly fans would be mad. I think New Yorkers would be mad, but not filing lawsuits mad.
Yeah, no, no.
But multiple lawsuits have been filed against a blown call in a football game. There was a senator from Louisiana who was holding up court in the Senate today. Damn. There are talks about...
Like we in the middle of a government shutdown and you trying to talk about these things.
Yeah. Oh, shout out to the shutdown being over for like 3 weeks. So.
Yes, yes. I think it's real interesting that after we launched the Patreon the later, the government comes back. So I think that it might be a correlation between the two, brother. Maybe. Pelosi and Trump are like, we got to do something about these Negroes. They launched the Patreon.
And then New Orleans. So there are talks about the bars in New Orleans not showing the Super Bowl at all.
Yeah.
And instead showing the Super Bowl from, I guess, 2010 when they won?
When they beat the Colts?
They beat the Colts, yeah. So that's going to be interesting, too, what the rating is at in New Orleans. Not that New Orleans and St. Louis are huge markets, but I think they are. New Orleans, historically, for football season, like the Sunday night games, Monday night games, they are usually number one when it comes to the rating and the share. So if New Orleans absolutely does hold through and not watch the Super Bowl, I think that will sort of make an impact a little bit on the final number.
I do think the ratings might be down a bit. I mean, it's still going to be huge just because it's the Super Bowl and it's an event. But I do think not having a compelling – like the Rams are a good team, but I don't know if they're a compelling team in terms of the average fan that doesn't have an allegiance to either team. Like Philly last year – they were the underdogs. They were coming in with their backup quarterback. Philly had never won a championship or you know, they never won a Super Bowl. And so there was some intrigue to it. I think this year's ratings will probably be on par with the Atlanta Patriots Super Bowl in that if you're a fan of the team playing the Patriots, you'll be watching. But if not, you know, you'll still have it on, maybe. Or you might find something else to do that night. So... like I will be watching. I'll have to break out my my Tecmo Bowl Eric Dickerson jersey and root on these Rams because I tell you what, the country doesn't need Marcus is another Super Bowl in New England.
No, I think the ratings are down a little bit from last year's games.
Yeah,
which surprised me because as you can probably relate to the weather. On Sunday, it was pretty bad across the east. It was pretty cold. It was even cold down south. It was in the 30s down in Atlanta. For the Super Bowl, I think we saw with the World Series with the Dodgers and the Red Sox, which did not do well. It was a disappointment with the ratings. I think part of that is, you know, if you're a flyover state, you really don't have any ties to Dodgers or the Red Sox, and you know, there's probably some not Red Sox fatigue, like the Patriots fatigue I'm about to discuss, but there's nothing really to root for. I think you're going to see some Patriots fatigue having them back in the Super Bowl. In LA, the funny stat that I saw was, and you know, part of this is due because of when the game started, but more people in LA watch the Patriots Chiefs game than the Rams Saints game. I don't think you're going to draw a huge number from LA for the Super Bowl because, you know, the Rams are still, you know, they're like the Clippers. They're still trying to find their their footing in the LA sports landscape.
Yes, like that pie in LA is so divided. What are you talking about? The Chargers, all 200 of their Charger fans in LA. The Rams, you got your Dodgers, you got UCLA, you got USC, you got LeBron and them boys with the Lakers. You got the Clippers. So, yeah, you've probably got a bunch of Raiders fans in L.A. too. So, it's like...
oh, yeah. I mean, the Raiders are the most popular team in L.A.
Damn. So, yeah, it's like if you're a fan in Los Angeles who likes the Rams, yeah, you'll get a certain percentage of that. But it's not going to be like if this were the Raiders and the Giants in the Super Bowl or something like that.
Yeah.
So, real quick, you talk about fatigue, Marcus Vandenberg. Where do you sit with these Patriots? Because I think, and I was talking with Bobby, Bobby Fresh, fan of the program, who's been on the show before, about this on the Sunday night when the Patriots won. My beef is not so much with the Patriots, even though I do have some bones to pick with Tom Brady. It's more with their fan base.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Patriots fans, and the same with Red Sox fans, too. It feels like a fan base that was, and forgive the analogy to the listeners and viewers out there, but it feels like Boston fans were like the abused spouse, and their husband was New York, and New York would just come in and beat up on their spouse every day and then leave and go to work. Beat up on their spouse every day and leave and go to work. And then finally, one day, Boston said, I'm not going to take it anymore. They cooked a hot pot of grits, and I don't know how Boston turned into this southern black lady all of a sudden, but just go with it. They cooked up a pot full of grits, threw it on New York, and said, I'm not going to take this anymore. I want my freedom. And everybody was behind him, and everybody was cheering for him, and Boston got their groove back. But now, much like that promo with CM Punk told John Cena he turned into the Yankees, Boston has kind of turned into the thing they hate the most in terms of their fan base, where they're obnoxious and they're over the top and their team can do no wrong even when we've seen them do wrong. That's just my take on the Boston fans.
I was going to call them jerks, so I'll just simplify my answer.
Who was that got the hot grits thrown at him? Was it Al Green?
Was it Al Green or Marvin Gaye?
Marvin Gaye, it was Al Green, because Marvin Gaye's daddy was a shot him.
That's right, so, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah, that's my analogy. The Boston sports fans are like Al Green's wife, who threw a hot pot of grits on Al Green because they couldn't take it no more.
I mean, Boston residents in general are an acquired taste. I love you, yeah. Bostonians, but you guys are special. So when you factor in
there, Marcus Vandenberg, we love our Sox.
Yeah. I mean, actually, for the World Series, they weren't that bad, actually. I think maybe they're bored with winning World Series now, but it didn't feel like they were the same Red Sox nation that I remembered from 2004.
Right.
But what was my point in all this besides Bostonians being special?
Patriots fatigue.
Yeah, Patriots. Oh well, I mean they're usually the most hated franchise in sports.
Yeah, they surpassed the Yankees. Like, because the Yankees.
Oh yeah.
The Yankees are actually kind of, we talked about this when Brian Shields was on the program, the Yankees are actually kind of tolerable right now. That may only last for another season, but I don't hate any other team in sports as much as I hate the Patriots.
I don't dislike the Yankees. I dislike Yankee fans. Yeah, I think this is a common. I mean, New York fans are almost just as bad, or probably just as bad as Boston fans. I mean,
yeah.
between the Knicks fans that are so thirsty for,
they just haven't success. Had a win in a while, so we don't really hear them.
And Yankee fans who will throw 27 rings in your face, Mets fans are sort of whatever at this point. Same with the Jets and Giants, but between the Knicks fans and the Yankees fans, it's pretty bad. So the Patriots, though. I think it's a combination of winning, Tom Brady being smug, and then Bill Belichick being Bill Belichick. You know, I think if Bill Belichick was Pete Carroll, I think that would sort of soften things a little
bit. Yeah, it would help. It would help.
And then you factor in, you know, Spygate and Deflategate.
Deflategate, all the gates.
All the gates. I mean, there's just a lot going on with this franchise.
Tom Brady and his friend Donald Trump.
There's that, too.
Yo, why did somebody send me a picture the other day? You know that incident that everybody's talking about that I think they're making too much of with the protests with those Catholic high school kids?
Oh, yes.
And the Indian guy and then the black Israelites and all that. To me, they got blown out of proportion. Why did somebody send me a screen cap of the white kid with the MAGA hat with the smug look on his face? He's like, this is how Tom Brady gets started. And I was like, that's wrong, but it's like that kid, it's Tom Brady. He's got the self-confidence. He knows he's good, and he's got his MAGA hat on for his buddy Trump. Like, that's Tom Brady Jr. right there.
Oh, man.
One day he, too, will have six rings on his hand.
That damn Mad Hat.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, come on, like Marcus. Let's be real. Okay, you were just in Atlanta, and I want to hear about some of your stories down there. But if you knew that there was a KKK rally being held outside of the Varsity for some reason, I don't know, in this hypothetical situation, and it was going to be like 50 to 150 KKK people out there, would you walk up to them with your Public Enemy hat on and your Colin Kaepernick t-shirt and just stand in their face and smile? Or would you be like, maybe this is an event I don't need to be at?
I might go to the cookout that day instead of the Varsity. I might pass.
Yeah, that hat is going to get a lot of people in trouble.
That's what it comes down to.
It'd be one thing if the kid was just a kid. He was there with, I don't even know where that school's at. I think Kentucky.
That sounds right.
Somewhere, it's either
Covington High
South,
School.
Or, yeah, it's either South or Midwest. But I can see if he had like a Chiefs hat on or a West Virginia basketball hat on for some reason. But you know, as soon as you put that hat on, you're looking for a reaction.
I have not seen a Madder hat out here recently. I saw a lot more in public after the election.
Yeah.
But it's been a while since I've seen one sort of out in the wild like that. And, I mean, when you see one, you sort of do a double take and you're like, oh, okay. Stay away from this person.
Public service announcement to all my white brothers and sisters. At least until 2020. Don't wear no red hat. I'm not even just saying MAGA hats. Don't wear a Cincinnati Reds hat. Don't wear the Boston Red Sox hat. Don't wear, who else wears red? A Chiefs hat. And if you're going to wear a Chiefs hat, get like the black version or the off-color version. Don't wear a red cap, because I don't have time between the time I see you and the time you get close to me to make out if that's a MAGA hat or not. I just see red hat, white skin. It might be a problem. So I'm just offering some friendly advice, because I don't want to see anybody in our audience end up on the news because they got.
You could have non-white MAGA supporters.
I mean, we have one that I know of, but
we do.
Your boy Yeezy.
Oh yes.
I put on this hat, Marcus. I felt like a Superman. Yeah. It was like I need to give my president the flyest stuff in the world.
That guy.
But real quick before we end the A block, Marcus, how was your time in Atlanta? And you were there. Were you there during Martin Luther King week?
I was.
Okay, so let the people know how that experience was.
It was a lot of fun. It was colder than expected. It was probably the coldest weekend of the.
Did it snow?
Far. It did not snow. It rained pretty heavy Saturday.
Because, if you got stopped on the side of the road, Chipper Jones would have had to come and get you out.
Yeah, Chipper would have kept driving.
He was like, hold on, Vandenberg's in trouble? You roll down the window.
Yeah. Oh,
I thought you was somebody else, buddy. Don't worry, I'll call for help.
Yeah. What did I
Ronald
do?
Ronald Acuna would have came and helped you.
Yeah, yes. Him and Ozzy Albies.
Yes.
Went to see the Hawks play twice. I saw the Hawks play twice.
Oh, you saw him twice. Okay.
Yes, I went Saturday night against the
Celtics. That was the toughest game.
Yes. Typical Hawks fashion, they come out strong and fell short.
Yep.
They, I will say, the State Farm Arena, formerly Phillips Arena, that renovation is pretty damn nice, Nate.
I've heard, man. I've seen some pictures. I heard people have gone there, talk about it. Matter of fact, we were talking the night you went to the Celtics game, and I was joking about you going to Killer Mike's Barbershop.
Yes.
In the arena, which is still, that fits Atlanta. Like, yeah, we're going to have a black barbershop in the middle of our basketball arena.
Yeah, so when you walk in, to your left is Killer Mike's Barbershop, and it's a working barbershop. You can get a haircut while sort of overlooking the arena and watching the game. I didn't go in to see what the rates were, but that is very Atlanta. And then sort of like the Braves and the Falcons, they have special items that are reduced prices on their menu. So like hot dogs, water, chips, I think Budweiser is like $5 for a can. Okay. So they have a set list of items that they try to sort of discount for the fans. Brand new scoreboard, beautiful scoreboard. It's a great sight line. So it was a fun experience. So
Trey Young was playing the second game you went to.
The Magic.
Ah.
As for the actual Hawks themselves, I think Trey Young is going to be a pretty solid point guard in this league.
Yeah.
Kevin Huerter is pretty damn good. He for a rookie. He did not play on Monday against the Magic, but he played against the Celtics. Very confident rookie, not afraid to shoot, got some size on him. Just seems like a solid player. I think John Collins is a star in the making.
Yeah.
I think the biggest thing with the Hawks is, besides the inconsistency, but they're just lacking, I think, that one veteran star on that team. They don't have that, and no. I know they'll have some money in the offseason, and I think they have maybe 2 picks in the top 10 of the draft, so I think they can reload that way and also maybe sign someone, but there's some pieces there that I think with some time they'll be a decent team in the future.
Yeah, I really like the Hawks. I think, like you said, Collins has a lot of potential. Trae Young, I'm a big fan of Trae Young. I know the Hawks got flack because they picked him instead of your boy Luka.
Yeah, wow.
Which, I mean, I get it, but at the same time, I think Trae's a better fit for Atlanta than Luka. And I think he can grow into something that, you know, I know the comparisons during draft week were to Steph Curry. Obviously, I don't think he's going to be that. But I think if you can get like a great value Steph Curry, that's still a pretty good player. Like if he's the Walmart version of Steph Curry, the store brand Steph Curry, he can win you some games.
He can. I think he's a better. I think he's a better passer than Steph Curry, to be honest.
Yeah.
You mentioned the trade. So the Hawks got a future first round pick in that deal. Which I think might be the pick they have. Let me see if I can check real quick. The pick they might have in this year's draft. So it's hard to really say if this was an even deal until they know what, you know, you're getting back. But yeah, currently they would have the 5th pick and the 9th pick.
They can draft. Do some damage with that.
And the 9th pick would be the Dallas pick, I believe. So
okay. As long as they don't trade up Bazemore, because, you know, we need some kids Bazemore in the building.
I was going to say, if you're going to move a guy off that team, I would probably trade Kent Bazemore.
you need the spirit, the enthusiasm that he provides off the bench, Marcus.
I mean, you do, but he's out of actual contract, which I'm sure if the Hawks can move him, they would, because
right.
He's making, let's see here. Oh, good Lord. Nate, do you want to guess how much Kent Bazemore is making this year?
This year? I'm going to say $5 million a year.
Oh, no.
More than 5?
Way more than 5.
Oh, no. 15?
18.
Damn. Go ahead, Kent. Get them checks, Kent.
So, yeah, this is why the Hawks probably would like to move Kent Bazemore.
Yeah. I mean, he's a good player if you get him at a good value. $18 million is not a good value.
Yeah, if he's making $5 million.
Yeah, if you can get, like I say, if you can get Kent for 5 to maybe $9 million, that's a good deal. But 18, I don't know.
Look what Bazemore does, and he sort of compare him to like a Taurean Prince, who Prince is making 2.5 this year.
Yeah.
Or even a DeAndre Bembry, who sort of sets a similar small forward role. He's making $1.5 million this year. So hey, the Hawks
I
have
man, get them checks, Kent.
The Hawks have these guys that are making very low. I mean, John Collins, for example, is making $2.5 million. Yeah. No, two million. So they have money to spend. They have more money to spend if they can move base more, and then
yeah. Vince Carter will come off the books next year.
Vince will be a free agent. You know what? If Vince wants to play, I think he should come back.
Yeah, I mean, he's still got a little bit left in the tank, and he's a veteran, like you were talking about earlier.
The other thing I noticed about this team, just from sort of watching from the sidelines, they seem to really like each other. I mean, whenever guys would check in and out, they would go out of the way to, like, acknowledge them, dap them up.
Yeah.
It's the little things that, okay, you see, like...
That's what you get from Kent Bazemore. He taught these young brothers how to dap, you know, because he had so much experience in Golden State, dapping up Steph, dapping up Clay. So he's like, when he comes out the game, you got to either go high with the high five or give him the fist so you can get a pound. So Kent Bazemore is teaching these young boys how to be professionals. That's worth $18 million, Marcus.
That's what it is. Okay.
Kent Bazemore is being paid for his intangibles. You can't put a price tag on intangibles.
No, you can't.
By the very definition, Marcus, it's something you can't touch.
Well, like I said, if you can move Kent Bazemore, you're going to lose Jeremy Lin.
Oh, that's right. I forgot Jeremy Lin was on this team.
Yeah, Lin is so popular. There are a lot of...
Was he playing or is he still hurt?
Huh?
So was he playing or is he still hurt?
Yeah, no, he was playing.
Okay.
Yeah, he was playing, so. And they lost to the Magic as well on Monday. The Magic aren't very good either, but they're better than the Hawks, so.
It's funny because I think they brought Jeremy Lin in to be a mentor for Trey.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know how long you need to keep the mentor on the roster. Because to me it looks like Trey's starting to get the hang of this thing.
I think so, and Jeremy Lin is still a very capable backup point guard.
Yeah.
Who, if you're a playoff team, he would make your team better. Will he make the Hawks better this year? You know, no, probably not, but...
at least not enough to make a difference.
No, not at all. So, fun times. I went to the World of Coke as well.
Okay.
Which I felt like I needed to do something very touristy being in Atlanta. So it was out of the aquarium and decided on the World of Coke. Which
so did you sample all the flavors?
I sampled some of the flavors, and then at that point, you know, when you walk in, they give you a soda. I was sort of like, all right, I've had my dose of the Coke for the day, soda for the day. So I sampled some, but yeah, there's a tasting room where you can... I think they advertise like 100 different sodas, but some of that is because they have like Coke Freestyle machines, so that's sort of cheating. But they have different stations for each continent, so they have like Africa, South America, North America, Europe. So,
so you made it a point to drink the African Coke.
I don't remember seeing African Coke. They have African
taste
sodas.
The motherland.
No. African soda, they had, I think, some type of flavor, maybe like a Fanta or something. Like, each country seemed to have their own flavored Fanta that we did not have in the U.S. But it was a good time. What else did I do? Just hung out with the family.
So did you go to
watch
cookout?
Football. I went to the cookout. I did that on Saturday night.
Okay.
It's a little overrated. Now, I've been told that the cookout, you need to have a milkshake to really get the full value of the cookout, but I can't drink
really
milkshakes. So that sort of, you know, it was fine. I can see why people like it. It's a lot of food for cheap.
It is. That is one thing. They do give you value for your money.
I mean, this is very American in the sense of, like, when you order, like, their combo, you're picking from, like, three different fields and, like, two of the options are like a burger and chicken nuggets, or a burger and a hot dog. Like, who needs both? I mean, just give me a burger and some fries. But
like, I don't want to eat like I just won the national championship and I got invited to the White House. Why so much food?
Do you think President Trump's been to the cookout?
I thought you were going to ask me when's the last time he's been to Atlanta, because that's another question.
That's a good question, too.
I don't think so. I think the cookout might be a little too niche for him. He's big American brands. He's McDonald's, KFC, Pizza Hut. He's big American brands.
He's definitely Chick-fil-A, right?
Yeah, I think he gets that in the Chick-fil-A. And then complains that they're not open on Sundays.
Yes.
You could be making so much more money if you were open on Sundays. It'd be huge.
I did not realize the cookout has been around for 30 years now.
Yeah, that's crazy. Like, I think we got a cookout here in Newport News, and I'll go there maybe once a month. But to me, the best time to have cookout is when you're traveling and you get it like on the side of the road, not on the side of the road, but you know, you pull off on the exit, you get some cookout. And then if you're not driving, you can fall asleep on the way back. I think their reputation maybe exceeds the quality of the food, but you should have had the milkshake because that would have tied everything together.
Okay. Wow. That won't happen. So, I did not have the varsity. I still have not had the varsity, unfortunately. I felt like having the varsity and the cookout in the same weekend was probably not the best idea.
It's too much, like going to two Hawks games.
I mean, I had Chick-fil-A.
Okay.
I had H&F Burger. I mean, I just had a bad diet, so I figured let's not overdo it.
Let's not push it.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So, yeah, that was Marcus's time in Atlanta. Before we go, did they have anything special for Dr. King when you were down there, since you were approaching the holiday?
We happened to drive past his old church and sort of his old neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
And there are definitely people out. I think there was some type of, as we were driving through, there was something about to happen because the cops were starting to come out.
Okay.
So I don't know what happens in Atlanta. I don't know if it's a parade. I'm sure it's a parade at some point, but it did not feel any different, I should say, from any other day. At the Hawks game, there was, you know, during the timeouts and stuff, like MOK videos, but it did not feel any different than, you know, a regular Monday in Atlanta.
Okay. Yeah, I'm assuming that's like if you're a Martin Luther King Jr. impersonator, like last week had to be your Christmas.
Does that even exist? Is that a thing?
Is that even a thing? Like, I'm sure that, like, there's, because they got to have people to come in and talk to, like, school kids and stuff. I'm sure there's like a limited Martin Luther King impersonator market out there.
You mean like an Elvis impersonator? Like someone just doing the full-on gimmick?
Yeah, somebody doing the full gimmick. Got the suit, got the Bible, just marching everywhere. Like,
that feels disrespectful.
Boys and girls, welcome Dr. King to the class. Good evening, boys and girls. I had a dream last night that Miss Finkelstein was going to invite me to talk to your class. Like, go ahead, earn your $50. That's how much I imagine he's getting paid, Marcus, this fictional Martin Luther King impersonator.
$50?
$50. Just enough to cover gas.
Hard times out here for Dr. King.
I mean, it was hard times back then for Dr. King. So.
Well, it was the hardest of times.
The hardest of times.
Yes.
Oh, man. So that's going to do it for the A block. We talked a little NFL. We recap Marcus's trip to the A. But coming up next on the other side, we know there are fans out there, the Kings of Sport, that like professional wrestling. And this is a big wrestling weekend. So we're going to talk some pro wrestling in the segment 4. Going to talk about the Royal Rumble. So Those listening on the classic version, the audio-only version of the podcast, will be back after the break. And those of you watching on Patreon, keep it right here, because we ain't going nowhere. And you might actually get some good stories during the break. So don't go anywhere, because Kings of Sport will be back right after this. Don't spit that cocaine like shouting. Set it on fire, they flame ain't like shouting. Blow, don't go insane, I'm mental. Blowing presidential, 20 bricks off in the rental. We official ATL is with plenty A to sell again. DEA on I tell again, we'll tell amigo Melodin. Yo, what trap nigga shit I did. Say you want 100 bricks, well I bet I get. Tell all the second nigga trying to rip my city. K-I-N-G, bitch, best get with it. All I know is go get it. Swear
what in the wide, wide world of sports is going on here? Got a Louis V bag, stay sacked up with it. Big diamonds in my cube and they won't be what we go shooting, man. When the A is undisputed, we some legend, best to do it, man. I keep it player, why some juice to play it safe? Go check the resume, it's risky business in the A. I keep it player, why some juice to play it safe? Go check the resume, it's risky business in the A.
Welcome back to the world's most dangerous sports show. Follow the danger online at facebook.com/thekingsofsport.
Can you dig it? Can you dig it? Can you dig it?
Welcome back to the Kings of Sport. It's time for the segment you guys and girls wait for each week. It is our repertory of ratchetness, our cornucopia of crazy, if you will. It is segment 4. And we've got some wrestling to talk about this week because, as we all know, wrestling and ratchetness go hand in hand. But before we get to that, Brother Marcus, I do want to send some shout-outs to our patrons. We have Brother Jermaine Jones, who we mentioned during the break. We have Steve Willie. We have the Professor, Christopher Marquise Ely. Scott Criscola. Faz Iqbal. John Pollock and Wei Ting. Shout out to the Post Wrestling crew. John Taylor. Rory Allenwick. Amy Lamont. And I believe that's it. Yep, that's it. So shout out to each and every one of our patrons, allow us to do some different and unique things with the show, including, you know, bringing you this video broadcast here. So, yeah, shout out to the patrons out there, Marcus.
Appreciate you all.
Even Jermaine. All right, so what we're going to talk about here in segment 4, Marcus, is professional wrestling. We got a big wrestling weekend coming up. Not only do we have the Royal Rumble, not only do we have NXT taking place in Phoenix this weekend, but we've also got some news to talk about regarding Ronda Rousey. And if you want, I don't know how much of the New Japan visa story you've heard. We can touch on that too if you want.
I heard enough to know not to buy tickets. I heard that much.
Wait until the card is confirmed.
Yes.
Oh, man. I wonder now that the shutdown is off, will that have any effect on it?
I mean, it's Friday, so.
Yeah.
And the shutdown, I mean, they still have to get it signed officially, so I think it's probably too late at this point.
Yeah. So, I mean, for those that didn't hear, the New Japan cards, and where's it taking place? Is it L.A.?
There's one in L.A., there's one in Nashville, and then there's one somewhere in North Carolina.
Yeah, in Charlotte. Yeah, so for those shows, the New Japan USA shows, it's pretty much just ROH shows now.
It's not even a good ROH show.
Ain't no bad ROH show.
No.
Well, yeah, it's like your ROH performers, because the Japanese performers couldn't get their visas worked out with the shutdown. So if you paid ahead.
All part of Donald Trump's master plan to help out the WWE.
Linda was like, Mr. Trump, I have a favor to ask of you. Can we shut down the government so New Japan's show will be ruined?
The main event of the LA card is Roppongi Vice reuniting against Juice Robinson and Tracy Williams. That is your main event. Your co-main is David Finlay versus Chucky T.
I think this tour, like, if there is one silver lining, like, it's Juice Robinson is going to get an opportunity to show he can be a top performer, because I think he's maybe one of the bigger names on the card.
Yeah, Skrull's on the card. Jeff Cobb's on the card. Juice. Colt Cabana. Jonathan Gresham was a pretty good wrestler. So
yeah.
But, I mean, this is not... You know, I thought it was weird that they were doing a Wednesday show anyways in LA, but yeah, the fact that they're doing, I kind of find it hard to believe that, I know they're using the shutdown as an excuse, but the New Beginning card is next Saturday and Sunday. They're running a show in the U.S. on Sunday, or on Saturday, so... I think regardless, the shows would have been pretty thin because you would probably not have anyone who's wrestling in Sapporo
right.
be here in the United States. So
that's logistically, that's not going to work.
That's not possible. So I don't think we were going to see any top talent anyway. So don't believe don't believe what you read.
How great would it have been, though, if that was the real reason for the shutdown and Trump came out today? I realize I've heard a lot of people. They don't want to see Juice Robinson. They want Okada. They want Omega. These are very fine individuals. So I'm going to bring them to you. The shutdown is over. New Japan have a huge show. But, yeah, that is a good lesson, Marcus. What's the phrase they always say on your ticket? Card subject to change.
Yes.
So, buyer beware when it comes to pre-ordering these tickets. Especially, like, if you pay for not only tickets, but people coming in out of town, and you pay for hotels and rental cars and stuff like that.
Yeah, that's... I'm curious to see what the backlash to this card will be, if any. I mean, it sold out in L.A., so they got their money.
So... we'll see how things go with New Japan. Let's pivot to the world of the WWE, Marcus. And in the lead up to SummerSlam, I guess technically we are leading up to SummerSlam a few months down the road. But in the immediate lead up to news came out about Ronda Rousey and her future with the company, Marcus. What did you make of this story?
I would tend to believe Ronda Rousey over Dave Meltzer, to be honest.
What are you saying about Dave?
I'm just saying, usually when you see a Dave Meltzer report, the talent usually does not dispute it. But in this case, the talent being Ronda Rousey, Ronda's not going to sit there and just sort of ignore the dirt sheets. She was pretty blunt in her response to ESPN. Quote, I honestly don't know why anyone feels like they're an authority to speak on the plans for my uterus. I should back up. So the Meltzer thing was like, Ronda's going to step away to have kids or start a family.
Yeah.
So that's why she's talking about her body parts.
Uterus.
Your uterus. If I responded every single time the world speculated what I was doing with my womb, I would not have a free moment in the day. I really don't feel like I should have to respond to this kind of thing. It's my vagina, my life. Keep the speculations to yourself. Leave me and my reproductive organs alone.
Wow. That's a beautiful quote. Beautiful quote.
Her contract supposedly is through 2021, so.
And then she can use her uterus
Your uterus.
That's, I mean, I think that's pretty, it's pretty definitive right there in terms of a statement by Ronda Rousey. Yeah, you and I talked about Big Dave on the show before, and then you know, his reporting, and a lot of times it's very credible. But in this instance, maybe he got a little bit of the wrong info from the wrong people, because Ronda was not here for that.
Not at all. It does sound like she might take a hiatus after WrestleMania, or consider a hiatus after WrestleMania. Yeah.
Which would be the worst thing for her.
No, and I mean, that's pretty common for wrestlers, usually. I mean, yeah, it's not the first time. It just so happens, you know, she's Ronda Rousey and she's a woman.
Especially if they do the Becky Ronda match like they've been talking about.
Yeah.
And you send Becky off with this great win, and that way, you know, Ronda can go away for a little bit, have time to, you know, relax, and then come back. She'll be a bigger star because we've had time to miss her.
And she can come back with Shayna Baszler.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. So that to me makes sense. I mean, obviously, the family stuff, we don't have any idea about that. That's between Ronda and her mans and her vagina, I guess. But I'm wondering, like, do you feel like if we just look at Ronda's run so far, from the in-ring debut at WrestleMania and the mixed tag with Kurt to now, I think she's been a good addition to the show. Has it been perfect? No. I still think they have her trying to cut promos that might be above her weight class, so to speak. But in-ring, I think she's done really well so far.
She has. I thought she would swing the needle more in terms of ratings and sort of viewership on the product. I don't know if that's the case or not, but it doesn't feel like it's been the case.
I will say, yeah, you're right. She doesn't feel as special as she did when she first came in.
Yeah, and I think if the trade-off is having Ronda on the show more to sort of build her up as an in-ring competitor compared to making her more of a Brock Lesnar type, then yeah, that's probably the right approach, because at the end of the day, she's going to be a better worker for it. But
yeah,
with that, she does not feel as special anymore, which is unfortunate, because I thought she could have been sort of that special attraction. But if she wants to be like any other WWE superstar, then so be it.
Yeah, I think she'll probably start to feel more special again, Marcus, by the time we really get to WrestleMania, because I think her and Becky, if that is the match, that will be, it might not be the last match, but I think it'll be a prominent match on the show. And the other thing is with the Fox deal, I think Fox is going to want to highlight her a lot.
Yeah.
When it gets around time for SmackDown to be on Fox. So, yeah, I think having her on most weeks has diminished her as a special attraction. But in the long run, I don't think it's going to hurt her or the company, for that matter.
Yeah, as for Mania, I don't see another match that's going to sort of knock that out of the main event spot. I mean, if it's Brock Lesnar versus
What about Shane versus The Miz? That's for the love of Vince McMahon's heart.
Oh, boy. Yeah, not so much.
Yeah, you're right, though. Just looking at the potential matches. Yeah, I can't see who would take that spot. And like, even if it's Rollins winning the Rumble, Rollins versus Brock, that's good, but it's not going to have as much heat as Ronda and Becky. Or maybe Ronda, Becky, Charlotte if they end up doing a three-way. Who knows?
Who knows about John Cena at this point?
Yeah.
Who knows about The Undertaker? But he would not be in the main event, regardless. So WrestleMania will be interesting. I mean, we'll learn a lot more after Sunday of which direction they're headed. But I think there are some decent pieces in there, but curious to see what they settle on.
I would agree. Speaking of those pieces, Marcus, let us talk about what is going on this weekend down in Phoenix, and that is Royal Rumble weekend. I heard it from my inside source. Let me play Dave Meltzer. I heard it from my inside source that Marcus Vandenberg was going to be in attendance at these events.
Well, you can tell your source that he's a beautiful young man with great hair. Yeah, I'm going to Phoenix. I will be there for TakeOver and for the Rumble this weekend. And looking forward to Tulane. I mean, funny enough, I was thinking about this earlier today. My first and only Rumble was 20 years ago at the Pond, 1999, which was probably the most infamous Royal Rumble for a couple of reasons. One, featured Vince McMahon. And then a whole Austin angle. And then B, that also featured Mankind and The Rock. And
yep.
That match was, I guess now looking back, it's a bit of a black eye. It was a violent affair. A lot of headshots. Yeah. That was, what was the documentary that was filmed that night?
Beyond the Mat.
Yeah, Beyond the Mat.
Beyond the Mat.
You've seen Beyond the Mat. That is a match that is profiled for Mick Foley, which is the Rumble, where his family's ringside, and he's just getting walloped on by The Rock. So, but yeah, I'm going to, 20 years later, going to my second Royal Rumble at Chase Field, which will be my first time going to Chase Field. Not to see the Diamondbacks, but to see wrestling, so... Should be fun. Going to be there with Andreas and Kel as well.
Okay.
From the Corner Podcast.
Yes, the Corner Podcast. Shout out to Andreas and Kel, who were very entertaining on Twitter this past week, talking about the Broner Pacquiao fight.
Yeah. Did you watch the fight, by the way?
No. I've seen the highlights, but I didn't watch it. I didn't pay for it.
Yeah, I didn't either.
Manny Pacquiao still out here on these streets.
Still, despite a busted eye, you still hanging in there. What's your excitement level with the Rumble?
I mean, I'm intrigued, but I couldn't say I'm excited, Marcus. Like, I'd even forgot this was the Royal Rumble weekend until we started talking about it before the show. I think you'll have some really good matches. Interested to see what they do with Brock and Finn. How they kind of map that match out. I don't think Finn's going to win, but it'll be interesting to see how they portray him. Can they still keep him strong even in a loss to Brock? The women's Rumble should be good. The men's Rumble should be good. And then after that, you know, there's not a whole lot else to it, you know, because your Rumbles are going to take up most of the time. I think it'll be a good show. Will it be something we remember 20 years from now like that Rumble you went to in Anaheim? Probably not.
Yeah. Someone on Twitter said, oh, this could be, on paper, this is an all-time great Rumble. And I said, I just don't see it. I'm sorry.
No. It'll be good. Like, I don't think there's anything that they put together, and I'm going to take a quick look at the card. I don't think there's anything they put together that would be quote-unquote bad, but all-time, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I mean, I forgot about last year's Rumble. Did you remember the Kane wrestled for the title last year in the three-way?
No, I forgot. Forgot all about that.
Kane, Brock, and Braun.
That's right. Yeah, that was the monster, like the Monsters Brawl or whatever.
Yeah.
I forgot all about that. All right, so yeah, we got the men's Rumble match, the women's Rumble match. Brock and Finn should be pretty good, depending on how they... lay it out. You got the four-way for the Cruiserweight title, which could be good match.
That's on the pre-show.
Okay, that's on the pre-show? Okay. Yep. You got Asuka versus Becky. Could be good. The Bar versus The Miz and Shane.
Yeah. I don't know. It might be a good story, but I don't know about a good match.
Right. Rusev versus Knock.
That's on the pre-show.
Oh, that's on the pre-show too? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And then Daniel Rousey. Bryan and AJ Styles.
And Rousey Banks.
And Rousey Banks. Rousey Banks doesn't really intrigue me. Bryan and Styles could be good. I mean, you know it'll be good in the ring at least.
Yeah. I think with both women's matches, it's sort of what's the outcome and how is this going to... impact who wins the Women's Rumble and set up Mania, because you could see a situation where Becky somehow loses, Ronda retains, Charlotte wins the Rumble, and they try to find a way to link all three. They've made it pretty clear that the winner can choose either champion.
Yeah.
So I don't see Charlotte choosing Asuka. The only logical way would be her to choose Rousey and then Becky try to get herself involved in a three-way.
Yep. That's what I'm thinking. I'm leaning towards that just because, A, I don't think they'll give the belt to Sasha over Rousey. And, B, on the other side of things, if you have Becky beating Asuka, then to me that complicates things because now she's got to defend on SmackDown. Whereas if she loses, then wins the Rumble, Charlotte wins the Rumble, excuse me, then you got two people going into Rousey, which I think would work. But I think the match will be good. I don't think they'll be great. Honestly, I think Rousey has better chemistry with Nia Jax, which is funny because I don't think Nia's some technical wizard, but I think just the size and physicality that they do works. It'll be interesting with Sasha, though, because Sasha is a good wrestler. She's a better wrestler than Nia, but I don't know if they'll have a better match, per se.
She is a more fragile wrestler. I feel like
yes.
Rousey could hurt Sasha if she wanted to.
Like, she could literally break her arms.
Yeah.
What about Asuka and Becky, though? Because it's going to be a situation where I don't think people are going to actively boo Asuka, but they'll certainly be more behind Becky.
Yeah, I don't see them booing Asuka. I feel like Becky's momentum slowed down a little bit. She's as hot as she was, and I'm not sure why that was. Maybe it was sort of going back to the Nia Jax injury where she was sort of sidelined for a bit, but part of it too was just people were overreacting to Becky in general and trying to make her to be, you know, she's not Steve Austin.
Don't go.
Yeah, no, like, stop. If you remember watching wrestling back in the late 90s compared to now, this is not,
I mean, Marcus,
not Steve Austin.
Steve Austin didn't have a Twitter game like Becky Lynch does.
Yeah, well, who cares? People aren't on Twitter. So that was a little over the top for me, to be honest, but I'm glad people are excited about the women in general, but let's cool it.
And I honestly think they wasted what potential they had with that Nia feud that you could have had being a placeholder. Because Nia had a lot of heat on her after that incident, and you could have, I don't think they paid it off. Like, they did something in a backstage skit at
when she got attacked by, she had TLC. She got beat up by Becky.
Yeah, and that was it. It's like you could have had a really good program with those two to take up time until you got to the Royal Rumble. But it felt like Becky's just kind of been floundering, not really floundering, but just kind of listless on SmackDown the last couple months. So hopefully this Women's Rumble and this show with her and Asuka, and then also Ronda and Sasha, can give us a clearer path once we come out of this night. It should be a good show on paper, Marcus. A good show, not a great show. I think Daniel and Styles will have the match of the night. I think the match that we'll be talking about the most, though, coming out of this, will probably be the Men's Rumble. If Seth Rollins doesn't win. Because I think my pick is Seth. I was leaning towards Cena, if Cena was going to be in this thing. But they could pull a swerve and give us Drew McIntyre, because we know they're hot on Drew McIntyre.
Yeah, they are. I think my pick was a long shot in Mustafa Ali.
Oh, I thought you were going to say a Velveteen Dream.
No, and him challenging Daniel Bryan for that belt.
That'd be really good. That'd be really good. I don't think they're going to do that, but that'd be really good.
The other thing too with the Rumble is always, you know, the surprises. And last year we had the Hurricane, and we had Rey Mysterio.
Okay.
And for the women's side, we had Lita, which I think was sort of known.
It was a bunch of them for the women's Rumble.
Tori Wilson, Molly Holly, Michelle McCool, Vicky Guerrero, Kelly Kelly, Jacqueline, Beth Phoenix, Breeze Return, and then Trish Status.
Yep. Wasn't Medusa part of that too? Or did she come out for Evolution?
That might have been...
Because they had the Battle Royale Evolution too.
That might have been Evolution.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, she was at Evolution. And the Vicky spot was at the Royal Rumble, which was a pretty cool little spot.
Yeah. So I don't know what to expect for the men in terms of a surprise. There's not a lot of people out there that I think would really excite people.
I mean, there's one guy, but it's not going to happen.
Oh, CM Punk? Yeah, I know.
Well, two guys then, CM Punk and Kenny Omega.
Oh, no, that's not happening either.
No.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Maybe this is Terry's big spot, Marcus. This is when Terry gets back in the ring, brother.
Don't say that. I will walk out. Terry
comes in and he eliminates the New Day and Apollo Crews at the same time.
I'm already going to a suspect state in Arizona, so don't give me any more reason to leave.
Sorry, brother. You got to go.
I think it's going to be...
You think we get any NXT call-ups as surprises?
I think we get Adam Cole and Velveteen Dream.
I could definitely see Cole. Dream would be fun.
I don't think they'll stay up, but I think they'll be in the Rumble.
Yeah,
they're not wrestling Saturday.
I was going to say, Dream's not wrestling or Cole on the... on the NXT show. So, yeah, that'd be fun. In terms of the women, the only surprise that I can think of that they haven't already used in terms of former people in their company would be like a Victoria. Because everybody else has gotten a call, pretty much.
It won't be Del Cham, that's for sure.
Melina, I don't think Melina's been in one of these.
That's all right.
So, but yeah, it won't be Gail Kim. Gail Kim ain't about that life.
No, not, nope.
Real quick on the NXT, because you're going to that show as well. Are you more enthusiastic about that show or the Rumble?
Oh, NXT, it's like five matches.
Yeah.
It starts early. I'll be done by like 7:30.
You had a rest of your night.
Yeah, this is already going to be great. It's already been a great show, and then it's going to be done early. No, I'm looking forward to NXT.
So you're not looking forward to spending 5 hours in the Diamondback Stadium?
I mean, it'll be fun. I mean, the Rumble's always fun, but it's a long time.
It is. It really is. I don't know why. When you own the network, you own how much time something has to be. Why not just make it shorter?
Especially when you've done years of running these pay-per-views and getting them done in 3 hours. Like,
yep.
There's no need to stretch out this show. Just figure out how to get it done in 3 hours.
Yeah. So that... Have fun with that, Marcus, because I'll be watching from the comfort of my home, but I will not be in attendance there. Phoenix, 5 hours, that's a long time to be in that heat, brother.
It's supposed to be only in the 70s, and I'm sure the roof will be closed. Well, that's a good question. I mean, the weather would be nice, so...
Yeah.
I think visually it would be pretty cool to have the roof open, but I'm not sure what's going to happen there.
Yeah, because I know a lot of times when they have that option, they like to keep it closed because of the sound. Because it sounds louder coming off of TV when you have the dome closed, but when it's open, a lot of that noise can kind of drift off. Mm-hmm. So we'll see. It should be. I think NXT will be a good show. I think the Rumble should be a solid show. Like with what they got on paper, I don't think it's possible for them to have a bad show unless they totally fumble on the Rumbles, so to speak, and go the wrong route with whoever wins the men's Rumble and the women's Rumble.
We'll see. And then, of course, Raw and SmackDown the next two nights after that.
So will you be there for that as well?
No. I'll be back Monday.
Like, can I interest you with some more of this programming?
No, I'll be back on.
Would you like 5 more hours of WWE in your life?
No, thanks.
Oh man, see, I think that's gonna do it for our thoughts on the Rumble, Marcus. Before we get out of here, there was something I need to bring up with you, though. You know, I think the viewers, particularly the people watching on Patreon, the people at home listen to the classic version, they can't see this, but the people at Patreon, I'm sure have keen eyes, Marcus, and they want to know, after our discussion about the MAGA hats early on in the program, why do you have a red hat displayed in your studio right now, sir?
This is the same hat that Jermaine was upset about. Oh, the Cincinnati Reds hat, yes.
Yes.
Man, I have other hats over here.
Yeah, but it's the red one that stands out, brother.
Got a Braves hat right here.
I see you got Braves, you got a Blue Jays.
Yeah, I got several Blue Jays hats that are hidden. I got a Padres hat. I got a Tacos hat. I have two Tacos hats. So
I'm surprised you don't have a... Who's the team that took the name from The Simpsons? Was it the Isotopes?
Isotopes, yes.
I'm surprised you don't have an Isotopes hat, being the big Simpsons fan that you are.
No, no Isotopes hat. And then I have Rhonda herself and her uterus.
Okay. Make sure her uterus is hers. She can make whatever decision she wants to make as a bobblehead.
Yes. So.
Where'd you get that from?
Funko's.
Okay, Funko makes some good stuff. I got my niece is into Teen Titans Go, the cartoon. Uh-huh. I got her one of the little Funkos for Christmas. She enjoyed that. Yeah, Funko's
wide,
got some good
products. Wide variety of
got a Razor Funkos Ramon
on my desk and on my my bookshelf over there.
Okay.
That you can't see. So
you got the list.
Yeah.
You should have a show like a Zack Ryder
about toys.
Oh yeah, showing all your wrestling toys. Funko.
Yeah, I have enough of them.
Okay.
Including the Tailspin collection. On the middle shelf. And then
they make Funko's for everything.
They do. My wife yesterday bought the George and Wheezy Jefferson Funko's.
Wow. You go too far, Funko. You're going too far.
I'm just waiting for the 227 brand to come out.
Real question is, do they have a Martin Luther King Funko?
They do not. You know, the family would not allow that. Come on.
It's like that, did you see that episode of the Boondocks where they imagined what would happen if Martin Luther King came back?
Yes, and, I have.
The bit where he's at McDonald's and they used him to advertise the McRib. Like, I really should have approval over this sort of thing. Oh man, but yeah, Funko. I like Funko, man. I have purposely decided not to purchase any for myself because I know once I start, I'd be the type of person.
Yeah, it's dangerous. I'm running out of room for these things. I don't know where else to sort of put them, so I'm trying to slow down some. That's some at work as well.
They almost got me because they had a Jordan Funko on I saw online the other day, and I almost
I've seen those. Yeah, I have not purchased one yet, but I know they have Jordan, they have a LeBron one.
Yep.
So I might have to indulge myself in a Jordan one at least.
Is it a LeBron with the Lakers, or is it Cleveland LeBron
with the Lakers?
Oh wow! Had to get that for Professor for Christmas.
Yes.
All right. So yeah, that'll be a new show, Marcus Vandenberg's Funko Review. Unboxing them, like those are pretty hot right now. Them unboxing videos.
Yes, they are.
Okay.
Peggy.
No time. You got Al.
We got Al.
Wow.
With the hands in his pants.
Yep. Funko, you're doing too much, Funko.
Yeah.
Yeah. Whoever thought of that, man? Whatever person or conglomerate thought of that, they're making money because
everyone. Yeah, I mean,
they're even at like Walmart, Target.
Yeah,
everybody loves Funko. So yeah, if you sign up to the Patreon, we will not send you a Funko, but maybe maybe you could tell us what kind of Funko you'd like, and we could talk to the Funko people. And that's as far as that conversation will go.
Yep.
Like Jermaine said, he would like a Funko based on Malcolm X. All right, we'll take that that under advisement. We'll get back to you.
Though, oh yeah, Obama Funko would be pretty hot.
Obama Funko would be cool. I know, speaking of Jermaine and the whole teppishness, I know they got some Killmonger Funkos, like at least two varieties I've seen.
They do.
Of Killmonger, which is which is crazy. And shout out to Black Panther for the Oscar nomination. They're not going to win. It's good to be nominated.
and Spike Lee.
They're not going to win, but it's good to be nominated.
Yeah, that winner.
Let's see. I think that's it, Marcus. I think that's going to do it for this week.
That is all I have.
So unless you got anything else, you know, the meds are starting to kick in. Feeling loosey-goosey. I want to stop the show before I say something that might get us in trouble.
All right. Let's wrap it up.
I start getting all political on Funkos. Is there a reason why the black Funkos don't have a mouth? Like, the white Funkos don't have a mouth either. They're trying to silence you, brother. Funko don't want you talking about the truth. They just want you to sit there on a shelf and do as you're told, brother. POP stands for pressure on the people. They're trying to oppress you, brothers.
Teaching devils.
So, Marcus, where can people find you on social media and find out about what you got going on? Maybe give you some tips of good places to eat when you're in Phoenix.
We've discussed Phoenix food on this podcast, but Phoenix is it's the south of the Southwest in terms of the chain restaurants from Papa Do's to Waffle House to Cracker Barrel
Is Phoenix Carl's Jr. country or are they Hardee's country?
It's still Carl's Jr.
Okay.
I think they even have Giordano's pizza. I mean, they have everything. It's a heaven for a fat. Whataburger. They have Sonic. I mean, it's heaven for fat kids. Culver's. I mean, they have Freddy's. They have stuff I've only seen in certain parts of the country. But
yep. I guess whatever workout program you were going to get onto after Georgia, it might have to wait another week.
Yeah, I'm going to try not to overdo it. They have Potbelly's, which I'm excited about because Potbelly's is the superior sandwich place. So, Marco Will, MarcoWill.
All right, that's where you can find Brother Marcus. You can find me at N8, MOZAIK, at Nate Mosaic on Twitter. Follow the show, Cospod, KOS_POD on Twitter, Cospod on Twitter. Check out our Facebook page, facebook.com/thekingsofsport. You can download the show on iTunes, Stitcher, Podcast Addict, Spotify, iHeartRadio Podcast, Google Podcasts. I think that's all of them that we're on. Wherever you get your podcast, that's where we are. Don't forget to check out the Patreon page. We got a bunch of different levels for the patrons that you can sign up and get bonus content. Matter of fact, not only this weekend will you get the video version of the podcast, which you're looking at right now, but we've also got the second edition of the Professor's 20 Twin Twin, where he's talking about Bernie Sanders this week. So that's always fun to catch up with the professor and get his political insight. We'll have to talk to him on the next episode about the shutdown and how he feels that might affect the candidates as we get closer to the 2020 election.
Speaking of, Nate, some breaking political news.
Uh-oh.
Guess who's running for president? Again.
Again?
Yep.
Not Hillary?
No.
Okay, good. Is it Bernie?
It's Bernie.
So yeah, we didn't even know he was going to announce, but it's perfect. It's perfect timing. Perfect timing. Bernie, for all the Bernie bros out there.
Yeah.
You might not want to listen to KME's episode because, I mean, he has some good things to say about Bernie, but there's also some negatives with it comes to
the negatives being my paycheck, so yeah.
Marcus is like, I don't want Bernie's hands in my pockets.
No, I don't.
I mean, that's Bernie is like a Robin Hood. You know, he takes from the light skins and gives to the dark skins.
Oh.
Bernie announced today, and then who else? Your girl announced this week, Kamala Harris.
Kamala Harris.
Yep.
And
I think it's like seven.
Did Elizabeth Warren announce yet or no?
Yeah, Warren was the first.
Okay.
So far, I think it's like Elizabeth Warren, Kirsten Gillibrand, Kamala Harris, Bernie Sanders, and I think it's Joaquin Santos, but it might be Julian Santos. They're twin brothers. I can't even tell which is which. One of the Santos brothers announced that he was going to run too. So it'll be a pretty big field in 2020.
I can't believe we're already doing this. I mean, yes, I know the election is next year technically, but yeah. I mean, come on.
And the only way to get it all figured out is by joining the Patreon for only $9.99 and get access to the 2020 Twin with KME. I like how you set me up for the plug. But yeah, that's where you can find all that stuff on the Kings of Sport Patreon. And I think that's all the plugs we got. So hope you enjoyed the show. Shout out to the people watching us on Patreon. And shout out to the people listening on the classic version. And a shout out to Toradol, because that Toradol hit the spot, folks.
There you go.
That's going to do it for this week's edition of the Kings of Sport. We'll be back next week, Marcus, with our, let's see. We'll probably have some more NFL to talk about. You know, that hot Pro Bowl, the Pro Bowl hot takes. We'll have some wrestling to talk about, the aftermath of the Royal Rumble.
Just some NBA.
Some NBA to talk about. And then the week after that, though, Marcus, and this is a little tease for our Patreon people. I already talked to TJ McClune today, and he's got some stories. So I think this sit down we have with TJ for the Patreon feed, hearing about his show going on in Super Bowl week in Atlanta, is going to be crazy.
All right.
So we got that to look forward to, and we'll see you back here next week for an all new edition of the world's most dangerous sports show, the Kings of Sport podcast. For Marcus Vandenberg, I am the Godfather, Nate Milton. Let's see, how do we want to end this one? Let's see. This would be a good time to have Martin Luther King impersonator come in and say something.
Where's your $50 at?
I ain't got it on me right now. But,
okay.
What I will say though is go Rams. I'm
save that for next week.
They need all the help they can get. So I'm go Rams. Okay. I'm going to say the same thing again next week. Go Rams. I need you to save us. You're our only hope. And you've been down with the Kings.
Well, that's all for this week's edition of the Kings of Sport. Be sure to come back next week for an all-new episode. You can leave feedback for the show on Twitter at KOS_POD or via Gmail at thekingsofsport@gmail.com. Don't forget to like and rate us on iTunes and tell a friend. The Kings of Sport is a production of the Mosaic Podcast Network.
Whether you like it or not, he's back. D-A-double-D-Y, fat sacks. Brand new Cadillac, being nice
and let me tell you something, Mean Gene. I'm going to go out there and I'm going to leave it all on the mat. Because that's what I do when I get it done so I can do it. Yeah!